countryside is on display. Pack up your caravans. We'll travel down a great highway through our wide sun-blessed land. The Leyland's Australia, great Aussie holidays. Australia, let the Leylands show you the way. The Leylands will show you Australia. Let the Leylands show you the way.
It seems ironic that Australia, the driest continent on our planet, has been shaped, eroded, moulded and modified by the erosive forces of water. An ancient, timeless land. Nowhere is this more evident than in the sandstone ranges of the eastern Kimberley in Western Australia's north. A landscape scarred by time and commonly known as the Bungle Bungles. On this leg of our great caravanning and camping adventure, we will travel west from the Bungle Bungles through the ancient landforms of the Kimberley to Broome on the coast. On the way, we'll see how tough it was during the gold rush at Halls Creek.
See the weathered landscape of the Minbi Caves.
Come on a boat cruise on Geikie Gorge.
See Windjana Gorge in the Kimberley.
Experience the huge tides of Derby.
Cook a fish fresh from the Wilderness River.
And visit Broome, the Pearl of the North. Formed 360 million years ago, the strange domes of the Bungles display a distinctive banding. The red sedimentary layers contain iron oxide, and the greyish-green layers an algae known as cyanobacteria. This small pond, rapidly diminishing in temperatures exceeding 40 degrees, is a lone pocket of survival between the furnace-hot mounds of rock. It is now nearing the end of the dry season. The pond may dry up altogether before replenishing monsoonal rains return to the north. Perhaps the only way to fully appreciate the huge scale of the Bungle Bungles is from a helicopter. This weird world is at the end of a rugged four-wheel drive track 115 kilometres away from the highway.
The road to the Bungles is rough and strictly four-wheel drive. We return to the highway, retrieve our caravans and continue our journey west.
On Christmas Day, 1885, a bloke called Charlie Hoare was in this area when he stooped down and picked up the best Christmas present of all, a gold nugget weighing 28 ounces. Now that was the beginning of the first gold rush in Western Australia. And today, this creek bears his name, Halls Creek.
The rush was short-lived, but for a while, thousands of hopeful prospectors trudged vast distances through little-known, inhospitable country to try their luck. The shanty town which sprung up on the banks of the creek soon developed into a more permanent community. One of its most prominent buildings, the post office, is all that survives today, if only as a weathered ruin.
In 1917, an incident took place in this mud brick building which was to have a major effect on people living in remote areas of the outback.
The postmaster, using a pocket knife and a razor blade, performed an operation on a young station hand named James Darcy. The doctor was in Perth. Instructions for the delicate procedure were meticulously tapped out using Morse code and telegraphed thousands of kilometres over thin steel wire to the remote emergency surgery.
Darcy survived the operation, but unfortunately died 3 weeks later, just one day before the doctor arrived from Perth. Today, little remains but a lonely graveyard and a few rusting relics. This tragedy, amongst others, highlighted the plight of all remote communities and led to the establishment of the Royal Flying Doctor Service, which now provides its mantle of safety throughout the outback.
Not far from Old Horse Creek Goldfields is an ancient structure which at first appears to be man-made. Known as China Wall, this remarkable outcrop of quartz is a natural phenomenon, stretching for many kilometres across the undulating terrain, a terrain so harsh that eventually it caused even the most determined miners to give up and head for easier pickings.
A shortage of water and a lack of flat ground for an airport caused the old goldfields to be abandoned and the new town of Falls Creek to be established 16 kilometres away. Today it is the hub of a large pastoral industry and a stopover for travellers passing through the rugged northwest.
Here the townsfolk have erected a statue depicting a feat of human endurance which epitomises the great Aussie tradition of mateship. At the height of the gold rush, when this country was trackless, Russian Jack carried his sick friend in a wheelbarrow for 300 kilometres to seek medical help.
Today a perfect sealed highway makes travelling a safe endeavour, but the distances are still vast, encouraging many travellers to use the few river campsites which are available.
Merripool, like many roadside stops along the highway, is very popular. Many people stop in here and camp overnight. And by the way, that's perfectly okay. The law says that you can stay for at least 24 hours.
This camp just off the highway offers plenty of shade and a tranquil outlook across the river. Campers must be self-contained as there are no facilities. A good place to unwind at the end of a long day's drive and freshen up for the journey ahead. Let the Leylands show you the way. I'm walking on an ancient seabed. 350 million years ago, this was all under the ocean and waves would be crashing on those cliff faces around me. Out on that seabed, way in the distance, we can see some grey rocks. These grey exposed rocks are limestone. And that's all that remains of a coral reef that followed this ancient coastline for 1,000 kilometres. Just off the coastline, the activity of small marine animals, including corals, constructed the massive barrier reef along the fringes of the old coast during a time referred to by geologists as the Devonian period. The mainland was then as mountainous as the Himalayas. Today, they have been eroded to a low-level plateau. The Great Northern Highway crosses the dried-up seabed, passing by the remnants of the ancient coral reef, a reef riddled with caves. And it is the caves which interest us.
We join up with a group of local Aboriginals who escort us through their tribal lands to one of their most revered places. This country is the traditional land of the Mimbi tribe, and our hosts know it well. The sculpted outcrops of ancient limestone harbour a maze of tunnels and caverns known as the Mimbi Caves.
Soon we're walking through a strange fluted landform, a grey canyon of stone spires which evoke thoughts of alien worlds.
Weathered old stones of the ancient reef is a subterranean labyrinth of tunnels and fissures of enormous proportions. The limestone has been honeycombed on the inside by the same erosive forces which shaped the striking exterior. Our guides soon lead us to a chamber decorated with crystal formations, formations which have been seen by so few. It's a great relief to escape the 40 degree heat outside, and an even greater balm to the soul when we round the bend to stand before an underground lake. Although quite deep, the crystal clear water is just a fraction of the huge volume which thunders through these caverns during the wet season to carve out a little more of the old reef.
Known for centuries to the Aboriginals, The Mimbi Caves have always been a good place to escape the tropical heat.
We leave the cool caverns of the Mimbi Caves to continue our journey westward to Fitzroy Crossing. This small town on the banks of the Fitzroy River derives its name from the old crossing of the riverbed. The long causeway is a curiosity to today's visitors, but for a long time it was the only means of crossing the mighty river. In the dry season it is unremarkable, but in the wet, roaring cascades engorge the river, and in the past closed the Great Northern Highway every year. A modern high-level bridge has eliminated the problem.
Fitzroy Crossing may be a small town, but it still boasts a modern caravan park and tourist village for dusty and weary travellers. Next morning, refreshed from a good night's rest, we join a cruise down one of Kimberley's best known and most beautiful gorges, Geikie Gorge. The cruises are conducted by rangers from the national park which encircles it.
High on the cliffs, about 16 metres above the present level of the river, the white bleaching of the limestone marks the height of the wet season waters which flood through this narrow canyon.
In full flow during the wet season, the Fitzroy River at Geikie Gorge is the second fastest flowing river in the world. Only the Amazon in South America is greater. It could fill Sydney Harbour in 21 hours.
The voyage takes in a small portion of the 14-kilometre length of the gorge. The Fitzroy is one of the world's great rivers, and Geikie Gorge, one of the world's wildest places. To investigate the region surrounding Fitzroy Crossing, we leave our caravans in the security of the caravan park and set off in the two four-wheel drive vehicles. Most of the roads, other than the main highway, are gravel. We decide to head north on a circuit trip through the Kimberley, which will include Tunnel Creek and Windjana Gorge.
Our route once more takes us through country dominated by the limestone remnants of the ancient Devonian Reef. Our first stop is a place in that reef where a creek has worn a tunnel 750 metres through the Napier Range. Visitors can walk right through Tunnel Creek, but torches are necessary. This cave was used by Aborigines of the region. Evidence of their passing is painted high on the ceiling of the tunnel.
Perhaps the most famous of those Aboriginals was Jundamurra. He became quite notorious as a rebel leader who took up arms against the early pioneering settlers in the 1890s. After 3 years of eluding police by hiding in the many caves of the ranges, he was killed in a gun battle just opposite the entrance to the tunnel. Hiding places like these have a multitude of concealed entrances and exits. It's easy to see how an Aboriginal with intimate knowledge of the ranges and his many caves could avoid capture.
Jundamurra first fell foul of the law by spear and sword. Recognising his skills as a horseman and marksman, the police used him to work for them as a tracker on the ticket, quickly gained a reputation as one of the best trackers in the community.
Just 30 kilometres from Tunnel Creek is Lilimalura Police Outpost, where he turned against Constable Richardson after assisting him to capture members of his own tribe. Here he killed Richardson, stole guns and set the captives free. In November 1894, Jundamurra and his band of followers attacked a party of settlers driving cattle into the Kimberley. Two were murdered. For the next 3 years, he terrorised pastoralists, effectively keeping them out of his tribal lands. All that survives today are the ruins of the old police outpost and the legend of Jundamurra's exploits.
Just 15 minutes away is Windjana Gorge, the site of Jundamurra's murderous attack in 1894. This sensational gorge, cut through the limestone by the Leyland River, attracts thousands of visitors every year. They come to view the striking scenery and to participate in one of the world's great wildlife experiences. Marine creatures which once swam in the Devonian Sea 350 million years ago are preserved as fossils in the ancient barrier reef, a tangible link with our prehistoric past.
The biggest attraction of Windjana Gorge, though, is what is often described as a living fossil, the crocodile. Essentially unchanged through millions of years of evolution, crocodiles occupy the sunny sandbanks of the gorge in large numbers. A recent survey of the gorge by wildlife experts indicate that over 400 crocodiles live in Windjana Gorge. Some are 3 metres in length, which is about as big as a fully grown freshwater crocodile can get.
One of the great features of Windjana Gorge is the fact that there are lots of these freshwater crocodiles in the gorge, and you can get this close to them. This is a unique experience anywhere in the world.
We retreat to a few shady trees, partake of a few refreshments, then return to the vehicles.
Cattle are frequently found on most roads in the Kimberley, for this is cattle country and has been since the late 1880s. The story of how it came to be so is a remarkable one of courage and far-reaching vision. Inspired by reports of extensive grazing land, the McDonald brothers, Willie and Charlie, set off from their property at Clifford's Creek in New South Wales with 670 head of cattle, 60 horses and 2 wagons. On what was to become the longest overland cattle drive ever made. They reached the Kimberley in June 1886 and named their new million-acre property Fossil Downs.
Fossil Downs is still in the family and run by fourth-generation descendants of the pioneering McDonalds. Although not open to the public, we accept an invitation to visit this historic and truly amazing homestead where the pioneering spirit has persevered through some rugged times.
Built to last, the imposing main homestead could give the impression of great wealth, but this is not so. It was built by the parents of our present-day host, Annette. Her father, William McDonald, nephew of the original Willie, who overlanded the cattle from New South Wales, married Maxine Darrow in 1938.
They started building the homestead in 1939, but the Second World War, lack of money, droughts, transport difficulties, and a shortage of materials meant the impressive project took over 11 years to complete. Fossil Downs was used as an airbase during the war. Maxine decoded messages for the army and learned to dismantle a machine gun during this time. William used his knowledge of edible native fauna and bush tucker to document survival information for the military. He also mapped the entire area. Of course, they also ran the property, tackling day-to-day chores. William died in 1963, but Maxine lived for a further 25 years, making a lasting contribution to the region. Always the perfect host at this wonderful oasis in the heat and dust of the Kimberley.
Determined to provide Fossil Downs with a sense of style, William and Maxine furnished their home with the very best that they could afford. What they couldn't buy, they made. Undaunted by criticism that they may be building a needless mansion in the outback, they persevered until the job was complete. Taking pride of place on the upstairs balcony is a saddlebag, which made that historic overland trek in 1886.
Everything here at the McDonald homestead has a bit of a story. This billiard table, for example, was salvaged from the wreckage of the hotel in at Broome after the Japanese bombed it during the Second World War.
This beautiful homestead was built by 2 very extraordinary people in some very difficult times. Every single brick was made by hand in the bed of the Fitzroy River using sand from the river. It's proof of what can be achieved from hard work and dedication.
Maxine and William are buried in the family plot at the back of the homestead, but the pioneering spirit of both of them and their forebears lives on at Fossil Downs in the Kimberley.
Let the Leylands show you the way.
From Fitzroy Crossing, the Great Northern Highway leads us across 256 kilometres to the coastal town of Derby. established in the early 1880s to service the needs of pastoralists who were taking up land in the Kimberley region, Derby became the main port of the northwest. Orderly ranks of unique boab trees with their distinctive bottle-shaped trunks lined the main street. These unusual trees, which often take on grotesquely distorted shapes, have become symbols of the north.
Just outside town is one magnificent example about 1,500 years old. It is almost 15 metres around the girth and is hollow. With one small entrance in the side, it made an ideal natural prison and was used for this purpose by the police in the early days.
It's actually a lot bigger in here than it seems. About 20 prisoners at a time were held here before going the next 7 kilometres onto Derby.
We decide to base ourselves in town for about a week, so we check into Derby's one and only caravan park.
The distinctive boab tree is a powerful symbol of the north, but not the only one. For the Aboriginals, whose ancestors have roamed this land for centuries, the image of Windjana, a mythical dreamtime figure, is a potent symbol of the region. At Malamjum Aboriginal community on the outskirts of town, Ian Healy carves small pendants of Windjana figures from mother-of-pearl shell. Windjana figures feature strongly in most Aboriginal art from this part of Australia. It can be found on cave paintings which date back thousands of years, and it can be found in modern paintings, much of which is produced by a small group of talented artists at the Malamjum community.
Visitors are encouraged to visit the community and see the artists at work. Although Donnie Wool Goodger hasn't been painting for long, his talent is obvious. Some of his paintings are already fetching high prices at auctions in the cities. To the people of Malamjum, the Windjana is the supreme spirit being. According to Aboriginal legend, the Windjana created everything in and on the earth and also laid down the rules by which the people should live. The Windjana is not only one of the oldest, but also one of the most powerful images represented in all Aboriginal art.
Perhaps the most extraordinary thing about Derby is that a port was ever developed here at all. The tidal rise and fall here is the second largest in the southern hemisphere at 11.5 metres. Today, an extraordinary jetty stretches out across the mudflats, which once presented such a difficult obstacle to shipping. Every day when the tide turns, the sun-baked barren mudflats are inundated with the encroaching frothy waters of the Indian Ocean. Creeping slowly at first, the rising waters quickly gain speed, racing across the featureless coastline. On the ground, we follow the coastal highway toward Broome.
We're about to turn off the highway just south of Derby to a really good campsite on the Fitzroy River.
The track we're following is part of the original road which connected Derby with Broome before the present highway was put in. Our destination is a spot known as Telegraph Pool. track runs through private property, which the owner kindly allows travellers to use. So it's important to travel carefully and make sure all gates are left as they are found. Telegraph Pool is not only a good campsite, it also has a great reputation as a fishing spot.
I've never done much fishing, but I thought I may as well try my luck. If these waters really are teeming with fish, I'll soon know. It's a threadfin salmon. These fish are considered to be one of the best available in the northern waters of Western Australia. Not bad for my first effort. Just over 3 kilograms in one fish.
I've decided to serve the fish with a chilli sauce, which takes just a few moments to make on the camp stove.
To a saucepan, add 2 tablespoons of oil, then half an onion sliced, half a red capsicum, and half a teaspoon of fresh ginger. Slowly cook that for a few minutes. Into a bowl, I'll now mix 2 tablespoons of sugar, half a cup of pineapple juice, 2 tablespoons of tomato sauce, 2 tablespoons of vinegar, 1 teaspoon of soy sauce, 2 teaspoons of corn flour. And mix that all together. Add this to the onion capsicum mixture. Return it to the heat. Remove all those insects while you're waiting for it to thicken. Add 2 slices of pineapple and 1.5 teaspoons of chili sauce. Stir it all through and then serve it with the fish.
To cook the fish, I'm simply frying it on a hot plate with a little butter.
Smells all right. Robert filleted the fish, that's why big chunky bits. Break the lemon up, squeeze it a bit over the fish.
It takes just a few minutes to cook. Threadfin salmon is best when fresh, as it does not freeze very well. Next up, Broome.
Established in the 1880s, Broome is undoubtedly the capital of the Northwest. With a sizeable population, it has all modern conveniences.
Our first call is to the post office to collect mail forwarded for us. It could hardly go unnoticed, even to the most casual observer, that Broome is a pearling town. A bronze statue in the main street of a diver pays tribute to the many brave men who risked and often lost their lives in search of pearl shell from the sea floor.
Many of the divers were Japanese. They worked at depths of up to 27 metres, resulting in an appallingly high death rate, a fact to which the large number of graves in the Japanese section of the cemetery bear mute testimony.
The grand old pearling luggers no longer ply the waters of Roebuck Bay upon which Broome is built, but a few were saved from the scrap heap, restored and placed on display for visitors to see. Complete in every detail, these vessels were once the pride of the pearling fleets of Broome. When rich pearling grounds were found off the coast of Broome, a shanty town sprung up in the sandhills around Roebuck Bay. The town soon developed, and at its height, 350 of these luggers were employing over 3,000 men to recover pearl shell from the sea. The pearl shell was used in the manufacture of buttons, knife handles, and other ornamental objects. The diver's life was a dangerous one. Working in deep water and using heavy and cumbersome suits, the men were totally dependent upon the crew pumping fresh air from the lugger above. Receiving air through a vital lifeline was not the only hazard for divers. Sharks, entanglement with underwater objects, the bends and strong tidal currents were all part of daily life for pearl divers.
So every day they were still luggers. They came in very, very successful divers. Well, this is how the divers got their air in the early days. It was a three-cylinder pump. They'd have a couple of blokes winding these handles like this. Okay, sending the air down to the diver. If they went for smoke over, you were down there diving, that was the end of you.
The divers took great risks to recover the pearl shell oysters from the deep. But it was not just the romance and adventure which attracted them. There was always a 1 in 10,000 chance they may find an elusive natural pearl whenever they opened the shell.
The waters around Broome are absolutely perfect for growing oysters like this. And of course, these are the type of oysters which produce pearls.
The cultured pearls produced by these large oysters are considered the finest in the world. It seems ironic that something so unattractive as an oyster can produce something so beautiful as a pearl. The process of cultured pearl farming was once shrouded in secrecy, but today we can visit Willie Creek Pearl Farm to see exactly how it is done. The first step is to insert a spherical nucleus into the oyster. It is then returned to the sea where it secretes nacre, a substance which envelops the nucleus, giving it the distinctive lustrous sheen of mother of pearl. If all goes well, the oyster is opened in 2 years to reveal a beautiful cultured pearl.
After producing two such gems, a different operation results in the growth of half-round or blister pearls on the shell itself. Willie Creek also has an extensive display of completed pearl jewellery from which to choose. If a perfectly matched pair of earrings or a braided strand necklace is on the shopping list, then bring a big checkbook. These will cost $20,000. You better put them back.
The mudflats exposed at low tide in Roebuck Bay may no longer clamour to the sounds of sailors readying their luggers, but they do echo with a new sound for a new century, the sound of a hovercraft. This novel means of transport operates every day, taking tourists on flights across the exposed mudflats around Broome. The hovercraft is eminently suited to the conditions. It can scoot across the open sea or exposed sand with equal ease. The sunset flight includes a trip up the Collar Creek where the whirling luggers were once moored. A great demonstration of the hovercraft's ability to negotiate rougher.
Our destination is on the opposite side of the bay, where millions of years ago dinosaurs once roamed across ancient mudflats. The imprints of their feet have been preserved in the exposed sandstone. A story fully explained by our guide and pilot.
You'll notice here the difference between the densities. Yeah, that gives me a bit of an idea. I thought that initially it was a three-toed one with the two outside toes chopped off, but I was advised by the geologists who were here a couple of months ago that it is indeed a single-toed blepharopod. And the skeletal structure of that fellow is exactly the same as a chook. So you've got this 2.5 to 3 metre chook.
To cap off a perfect day, the setting sun turns on a glorious timeless ritual, much the same as it must have been when the dinosaurs plodded across these mudflats.
Let the Leylands show you the way.
We are now keen to explore the region north of Broome, known as Dampier Peninsula. As this country is too rough for the caravans, we leave them in the security of the caravan park. The journey ahead will take us to Cape Leveque, a distance of over 220 kilometres. The first stop is Bungle Bungles, founded in 1890 and was the first Aboriginal mission established in the Kimberley. The church here is unique. It was built by Palatine monks and completed in 1918. The Aboriginal parishioners, obviously inspired by their links with the pearling industry, have stunningly decorated the inside of the church and the altar with mother of pearl shell.
The road north is quite narrow in places. It pays to stay alert, for even though it may be a remote road, it is quite popular with tourists during the dry season, and head-on collisions are not unknown.
It's dusk by the time we reach Cape Leveque. For the next few days, we will camp in a rustic bark hut right on the beach. These facilities are available for rent at Kuljaman, a tourist village incentive of the nearby Aboriginal community of One Arm Point. With full bellies and protection from mosquitoes, it's time to call it a day.
With morning, we get our first chance to have a good look around the Cape, and it doesn't get much better than this.
This coastline is so remote and untamed that we can easily imagine we're the only people here. The pristine beauty is unmatched anywhere in Australia. To explore the coastal region more thoroughly, we join two brothers, Alec and Philip McCarthy, to take a full day's cruise on their high-speed boat, the ultimate experience.
Hello,
what do you want to drive today? Alec, who prefers to be known by the
skipper. Just beyond this crack up here, there's a big waterhole that gets filled up during the wet, only gets filled up during the wet, and about two to three months after the wet, so there's ongoing waterhole. Ongoing water, that fresh water, that the people just, our people just travel on by raft, just come there for water.
Unja and Philip's ancestors knew all the islands of these waters well. The two brothers are carrying on the traditions of their seafaring tribal origins and are having to pass on their property knowledge to travel. They grew up roaming around these islands and have an intimate knowledge of them. They spent their childhood at a mission station on Sunday Island, which is where we are headed.
The mission settlement on Sunday Island was abandoned years ago because of the rising cost of ferrying supplies over from the mainland. Little remains of the buildings, but the layout of the small settlement with its streets, gardens and orchards is clearly visible from a high ridge overlooking the shallow valley where it once stood. Rusting relics littered throughout the settlement is all that remains to indicate how sizable the island community was.
There are over 1,000 islands in the Buccaneer Archipelago, which can be a navigational nightmare for anyone who hasn't been here before. Most of the islands are uninhabited, and only a few have supplies of fresh water. The English explorer and adventurer William Dampier came this way in 1688. He was at that time a member of a company of buccaneers. He found it difficult to find fresh water and thought the land to be barren and its people worthless. Had he been privy to the local knowledge of Unja's predecessors, perhaps his reports on the region would have been more glowing, and maybe Australia would have been settled 100 years earlier than it was.
We drop anchor on a small idyllic island, which Anja assures us has a plentiful supply of fresh water and is a great place for lunch.
Mother-in-law has to walk.
Sure enough, in a small gully just behind the beach is a stream of crystal clear fresh water in a shallow pond in which it lives. Just what Dampier was looking for over three centuries ago.
For lunch, Unja decides to make a traditional damper in the coals of a fire. With the dough well covered with dry flour, it is simply placed directly into the ashes and covered for about 35 minutes.
Long before there was any civilization in this area, The voyages of William Dampier through these beautiful tropical waters so inspired a young writer in London that he later wrote a book about a man who was marooned on an island just like this. His fictional character survived on his island paradise by using his wits and knowledge. The writer was Daniel Defoe, and the book, Robinson Crusoe. Who knows, perhaps this was the very island he had in mind.
Back on board, under in port, things take us to a place where we can observe the huge coral reefs which make this water's both treacherous and tantalizing. We can only stay in a good spot for a short time. At 10 and 11 metre tides, rocks just under the surface can quickly turn into exposed outcrops of land. Strong currents twist and turn between a multitude of islands, and whirlpools appear in the middle of the ocean. Schools of fish caught up in the swirling waters become easy prey for seabirds.
We try some fishing too. We need only drop a line in the water for a few minutes.
That's for you. This is your tea tonight, my friend.
And you don't have to be an expert to catch them either. What is it?
Spanish flag.
Spanish flag.
Unger and Philip are anxious to show us what they say is one of the most amazing tidal waters in Australia. But we must get there quickly as the tide is running out of faith. They won't tell us what it is just yet. Along the way, we pass a pair of whales frolicking in the tropical water. Suddenly, there is Unger's surprise. A coral reef emerging from the sea like some giant creature. The tide is rushing out so fast that the reef is becoming a huge water field in the middle of the ocean. An astonishing cascade stretching off to the horizon at a place where only hours earlier there was nothing but still blue water. Within minutes, the waterfall has grown from a small gradient to a 2 metre fall and is still growing. We have time to quickly inspect the reef on foot, but not for long. Soon, this marvellous phenomenon of the natural world will protrude even further and could leave our boat high and dry. This astonishing tidal effect, a waterfall in the middle of the ocean, is sure one of Australia's most unusual natural wonders. Next on Leyland's Australia, our caravanning adventure takes us down the west coast to Perth.
Cossack is now a collection of restored buildings.
Millstream Chichester National Park is often overlooked.
Let's see if we can find where the hole is.
The walk along the cliff edges of Yardie Creek is a great way to see the gorge.
Wildflowers seem to bloom all year round at Kalbarri.
The Pinnacles Desert is not too far from Perth, but looks like it belongs on another planet.
Next on Leyland's Australia.
Countryside is on display. Pack up your cap.
For great travel information, why not collect Leyland's Australia, the magazine? A new one will be in your newsagents every 3 months. If you like our TV shows, you'll love the magazine.
Leyland's Australia, great Aussie holidays. Australia, let the Leylands show you the way. The Leylands. We'll show